Good morning, everyone. We start our CMSA colloquium. Today, we are very pleased to have Doug Arnold as our speaker. Doug Arnold is a professor at the University of Minnesota, and he got his education from Brown University and his doctoral degree from the University of Chicago. He was a director of the Institute of Mathematics and its Applications in Minnesota. And Doug also served as the president of the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics. He works on computational mathematics, particularly on numerical analysis, PDEs, and mechanics. And he is known for the development of finite element exterior calculus. And today, Doug will talk about numerical discretization and geometry. Doug, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here, even virtually. I would have loved the opportunity to come and visit, and I hope that'll happen sometime in the future, get a chance to talk with you more. Let me mention, if anybody wants to follow up anything from the lecture, of course, it's easy to email or set up a video conference. And indeed, I will be talking mostly about finite element exterior calculus today. I think that's what people were looking for. But I'll put it in the broader context of structure preserving discretization. So first, mostly as a question of vocabulary, let me put up what I and many people call a fundamental theorem of numerical analysis, although it's all really more of a meta theorem. So it's just the terminology of what one thinks about when one does numerical analysis. You have a problem, and we'll represent it very abstractly as given data F in some space Y, find a solution U in some space X such that LU equals F. L can be anything. In my mind, it's usually a system of partial differential operators, and X and Y, for example, are Sobolev spaces. And in this slide, I'll imagine in any case, X and Y are vector spaces, and we're in the linear case to keep it simple. And then what's discretization? Well, it's replacing X and Y by finite dimensional spaces, LH by a finite dimensional operator, and the data FH by some approximation of F that lives in YH, and then you solve the finite dimensional problem. How do you check whether that was a good idea, whether that worked? Well, first of all, you usually do this for a sequence of discretization. So you think of H as a parameter going to zero to get more and more accurate. But for any value of H, you define three simple concepts. The error is essentially the difference between U and UH, and so you need a norm to measure that, but they live in different spaces, so you have to deal with that somehow. You introduce what I call a representative, capital U of little u, which is something you accept as close to little u and XH. So for example, if X is a function space on some domain, XH might be you put a grid in that domain and take functions defined only at the grid points, and capital U would be the restriction of little u to the grid points. Finite elements, it's something else. It's a finite element subspace. Okay, and of course, our goal is to get convergence that the error tends to zero. And this requires two concepts. One is consistency, where you introduce the consistency error, which is essentially the amount to which the exact solution, or really its representative, fails to satisfy the discrete equations. And you need a norm in the YH space for that. And consistency just means that as H goes to zero, the consistency error goes to zero. And then stability is the well-posedness of the discrete problem. That has nothing to do with the exact problem. It's just the norm of the inverse of the discrete operator. And stability is the boundedness of that. And once you've made those definitions, it's trivial to state and prove a theorem. The basic estimate is that the error is bounded by the product of those last two things, stability constant and consistency error. And so you have the fundamental theorem of numerical analysis, a discretization which is consistent and stable as convergent. So the reason I bring up this simple slide is we should keep consistency and stability in mind whenever we see a discretization. Okay, so let's get to structure preserving discretization. So the idea of structure preserving discretization is that there are some numerical methods which preserve on the discrete level key geometric or topological or algebraic structures possessed by the continuous system. When I say preserve, it means satisfy exactly, not up to order h or h squared or something like that. And these can have a huge effect on the performance of algorithms. So let me give a simple example. Suppose we're trying to solve the Kepler's problem, the one body problem of a planet orbiting around a massive star. So of course the differential equations can be written as a first order system in terms of the position of the planet and its velocity. The derivative, time derivative of position is velocity. The time derivative of velocity is proportional to the gravitational potential, which is a function of position. And then we can replace those derivatives by finite differences like I did on the bottom of this slide, where I evaluate the velocity and the gravitational potential. And then I set a forward difference of position and velocity to those things. And that's Euler's method. That's the simplest numerical method for a differential equation. And here I applied Euler's method to compute four periods over 200,000 time steps. And even with all those time steps, in four periods, the planet has deviated a great deal from the elliptical orbit we know it should be making. Now on the right-hand side, I do the exact same method, except I first evaluate the velocity, then I update the position, then I evaluate the potential, and then I update the velocity. Same amount of work, same effort, but that's a scheme that's called symplectic. It preserves a key geometric feature, and you see that scheme behaves rather well, and we can't see the difference between the orbits. Although if you look back at the end, you'll see the computed position of the planet deviates a little bit from its initial position. So it's still not a perfect method. And that's because Euler's method has a fairly big consistency error because it's only a first order method, even the symplectic Euler. We could go to a higher order method. So here I did the classical Runge cutoff fourth order method and did 1,000 periods. And so it takes longer. You need to go 1,000 periods, but the same phenomena happens. If you use the classical Runge cutoff method, you get bad results, but there's a symplectic method that takes a similar amount of effort in some sense called the four-stage Gauss-Legendre, and that you see gives us to our eyeball norm perfect results. This is a well-known theory, and there's even an excellent textbook on the subject by Herer, Lubitsch, and Wanner, for example. So let me give you a real application of this that was published in Nature in 2009 by Jacques Lascar and Michael Gastineau. They used a symplectic integrator to simulate the evolution of the solar system to see if the solar system would hold together for the next 5 billion years. So they did the n-body problem with all the planets and the moon, and they went out to 5 billion years. So how did they manage to get so far? Well, first of all, to answer their question of whether the solar system remained stable, they had to know the initial data more exactly than it's knowable now, because there's a large Lyapunov exponent for the solar system, and moving Mercury by a half a millimeter changes the stability of the solar system. So they took 2,500 different initial positions of Mercury, all differing by a half a millimeter. And for each of them, they did the computation. And you can see them here. They plotted all 2,500 of them on the same colorful graph. And you see about 1% of the orbits blow up. One of them as soon as in a billion years. So it says it's very likely the solar system will hold together that long, but not definite according to these computations. So my question is, how did they actually compute for so long and get an accurate computation? And the key part is symplecticity. And what is that? Well, it's the fact that both of these equations we've looked at, the n-body problem, the Kepler system, are Hamiltonian systems. So the flow map is a symplectic transformation, which means it preserves this differential two form. And so what does that mean? Well, among other things, it means that the flow is volume preserving. In 2D, that's exactly what it means. Here I've drawn the picture in phase space for the pendulum equation. You imagine phase space of any Hamiltonian system. You take some regions in the phase space where the initial conditions are, and you flow them forward and see how they develop. And what you see is they get distorted, but they don't change their volume. That's a property of the Hamiltonian system, symplecticity. Now we get to discretization. The discretization being symplectic, that means the flow map on the discrete level that takes us from time step n to time step n plus one is symplectic, preserves the symplectic two form, and it preserves it exactly, not just to order h to the r. Here I show what happens if you do it for Euler's method. It's not symplectic. You can see a change of volume from one time step to the next. And symplectic Euler, you see it does preserve the volume. And I'll go, let me mention, how do you analyze this? This has been thoroughly analyzed. The effect of symplecticity on the error analysis uses backward error analysis. It basically asks the following question. Here's an Euler equation where the true orbit in blue is a circle and the discrete orbit is spiraling off. But if you look at the discrete points, the red points, they're clearly following some sort of orbit of their own, and you can compute the equation of that orbit. So you can ask the question, what problem did the Euler method solve exactly? And the problem is some order H perturbation of the original Hamiltonian system. So the fact that it's an order H perturbation means we have a consistent method. However, it's the perturbed system is not Hamiltonian. That's the big difference with the symplectic method. If you do the symplectic Euler method, the perturbed system has one sign difference from the one from Euler's method. It's also an order H perturbation, but the difference is the perturbed system is Hamiltonian. So that's the property that we need. Okay, now let's go back to what Lascar and Gastineau did. They used a symplectic solver called SABA 4, which is quite sophisticated, has various other properties. They took a step length of 9 days, took 200 billion steps. And then remarkably, if you look at SABA 4, it's only second order. It only has an h squared in the consistency error, which seems like it wouldn't be enough, but they had a secret trick for that too. They exploited the problem that the n-body problem for the solar system is just a perturbation of the Kepler problem because the planetary mass is so small compared to the solar masses. And the actual consistency error breaks into two pieces. There is an h squared piece, but it has a coefficient of epsilon squared in front of it, where that epsilon is about 10 to the minus 3, the ratio of planetary mass to solar mass. And the second term even has a perturbation of epsilon h to the eighth. So this was a very small consistency error, which allowed them to carry out those calculations for so long using a symplectic integrator. Okay. So that was sort of a warm up to indicate what I mean by structure preserving discretization. And the rest of the talk is going to be devoted to finite element exterior calculus, which I would claim is maybe the canonical example of structure preserving discretization for partial differential equations. In some sense, there's now a reference for this subject. In 2018, I published this book. The theory goes back to maybe my plenary talk at the ICM in 2002, and then work I did with Falk and Winter and some long papers in 2008, 2010. But now there's a cast of hundreds of people working on finite element exterior calculus. I think I counted about 50 PhD theses and so forth. So it's nice to have a short book like the one here as a reference. The structure which is preserved in FEEC is captured by a Hilbert complex. So I'll talk about that a bunch. And a Hilbert complex brings a lot of subsidiary structure, including its cohomology and Hodge theory. Those are crucial things in FEEC. And the idea of FEEC is to design discretizations that reproduce those structures at the discrete level and thereby achieve stability, consistency, and therefore convergence. So what's a Hilbert complex? This goes back to Bruning and Lesch. Interestingly, when we were doing this, we didn't know about Bruning and Lesch while we were writing the paper. We invented the concept ourselves independently. We called it a Hilbert complex, which is exactly what they had called it. And then later, happily, before we published, we discovered their work and gave it proper credit in the paper. So a Hilbert complex is a sequence of Hilbert spaces, and we'll usually need up to three at a time, but very often these sequences are longer. So we have a sequence of Hilbert spaces W, K minus one, WK, and so forth. And on each one, we have an operator, and it may be a bounded linear operator, but we don't really assume it's bounded. It can be the generalization of bounded to unbounded operators called closed, which means it's not defined everywhere in WK necessarily. It's defined on some domain V. So for each K, you'd define an operator D with a densely defined domain V, and it should be a closed operator. And of course, the sequence should be a complex, which means if you do two Ds in a row, you get zero. We also require that the Hilbert complex be what I call closed, which means that the operators D have closed range, which is another property. That's a key one in the theory, but I won't get into it much here. And the motivating example is the Rham complex, which you can view either from a vector calculus point of view or a differential forms point of view. In vector calculus, let's say we have a domain in R3. You take all L2 functions on the domain, and you take their gradients as the first operator. And the gradient is, of course, doesn't map L2 into L2, so it's defined on a dense domain, which is the Sobolev space H1. That maps U into L2 vector fields, and the next operator is the curl. And that's a complex because the curl of the gradient is zero. So that's sort of our motivating example. And this would continue in R3. The next one would be the divergence operator. More generally, you can go on any Riemannian manifold and define the L2 Rham complex. And the notation here is L2 differential zero forms on omega are mapped by the exterior derivative to L2 differential one forms, which are mapped by its own exterior derivative and so forth. Okay, I claim that that fairly simple definition has lots and lots of structural consequences. So first of all, whenever you have a complex, you naturally go reach for the cohomology. Since the range of 1D is contained in the null space of the next D, you can form the quotient space and get the homology space script HK. Well, you get the homology space N mod R. And then we use the fact that we're in a Hilbert space context and say that we can always treat a quotient space as an orthogonal complement. So we can take the orthogonal complement of R and N, and those are called the harmonic forms, fractor HK. Also, when you have a Hilbert complex, you have a dual complex, have operators going back D star, going backwards with their own domains V star. There's a duality between the null space of D and the range of D star, their orthogonal complements. Then from those facts, you get the Hodge decomposition. So every Hilbert complex has a Hodge decomposition. The space WK breaks up as an orthogonal product of three spaces, the range of the incoming D, the range of the outcoming D star, and the harmonic forms. You get a Poincaré inequality, which is the key analytic tool. An element of W is bounded by D of itself if it's orthogonal to the null space. And many, many other properties come out of the Hilbert complex, and they apply to every Hilbert complex. Okay, what does this have to do with solving PDEs or operator equations? Well, if we look at this little piece of the Hilbert complex, starting at WK minus one going to WK plus one, and we put in also the dual operators D star, then we can start at WK and go left and then right, or right and then left, and add the two up and get DD star plus D star D, getting an operator from WK to WK, which is closed and densely defined. And that's the Hodge-Laplacian equation for this Hilbert complex. So every Hilbert complex has a Hodge-Laplacian for each K. So it represents a lot of differential equations. And the first theorem is that that equation is always well posed exactly up to the harmonic forms. That is, the harmonic forms are the null space of this operator. And if F is orthogonal to the harmonic forms, then there is a unique U that satisfies this equation up to the addition of a harmonic form. That's very crucial, so that the Hilbert space structure tells us exactly when this problem is well posed and how well posed it is. That's, of course, something we need to respect when we discretize. So that's one of the motivators of structure preserving discretization and finite element exterior calculus. The Hodge-Laplacian has an obvious weak form. You take the differential equation and you take its inner product, or its, you take its inner product with a test function V. And then you use duality to get the inner product of d star u with d star v, plus the inner product with du and dv is the inner product of f and v for all v for which this makes sense, namely v in the domain of both d and d star. So that's an obvious weak form that would be a starting place for finite elements. We could then take finite dimensional subspaces of v intersect v star to try to solve this equation. Turns out that doesn't work well, and I'll give you examples to show that. Much better is this mixed weak form where we introduce two variables. In addition to the original variable u satisfying the Hodge-Laplace equation, we introduce sigma, which is d star u. And the first equation just says that, that sigma equals d star u, but it says it in a weak sense. And the second equation then says that d sigma or d star u plus d star du is equal to f, which is the Hodge-Laplace equation. The advantage of the mixed weak form is the spaces that we have to discretize are just the V spaces, not this V intersect V star. Turns out that's much, much easier to do with finite elements. Now we don't have to stick to the Hodge-Laplacian. It's not the only equation we can solve using a Hilbert complex. So for example, we could take a Hodge wave equation or a Hodge heat equation. Here's the Hodge wave equation where we look for a function, but it depends also on u. So it's a map also on time, t. So it's a mapping from time into the spaces wk. And it satisfies u double dot plus the Hodge Laplacian of u is equal to zero, say, with initial conditions. That's some kind of wave equation. And just like I introduced the new variable sigma equals d star u for the Hodge-Laplacian, I introduce sigma and also rho as du for the wave equation. And I write the problem as a system. And you see, we get this interesting skew symmetric matrix in the system, which is going to be very helpful to get stability. And then that system can be written in weak form. And this is the way we would solve it with finite elements. And there's again a theorem that this is always well posed. In this case, the harmonic forms don't create a problem. For any initial data, there's a unique solution to this weak form in a precise sense. And here's a concrete example or a physical example of actually of the Hodge wave equation done in a slightly different way. So here's Maxwell's equations in the form that you can buy them printed on a t-shirt, four fields. The electric field E, the magnetic field B, and the electric and magnetic displacements D and H. To put this into a Hodge wave equation format, I use the spaces W0, W1, and W2, or L2 vector fields for W1 and W2, except the L2 inner product is a weighted inner product, weighted by the permittivity and the inverse permeability, epsilon and mu, that enter the Maxwell's equations. That's the only change I make. I change the L2 inner product to something equivalent, but with a weight. And then I write down the Hodge-Laplacian exactly as I had it on the previous slide. So exactly this, but where the inner products are the weighted inner products. Here, that's what I wrote in red over here. And the theorem is that, okay, notice I have three variables now, EB and what's sigma? Well, sigma is supposed to be the divergence of B. Let me get this right. Sigma should be D star, sorry. Sigma should be the divergence of D which should be zero. So sigma is supposed to turn out to be zero here, but the first, actually the sigma dot is the divergence of D. You can see it from the first equation. So it should be zero, but we don't assume it's zero. We solve for it as another variable. We solve at the same time for E and B. And the theorem says that if we choose our initial data, E and B, so they satisfy the necessary divergence-free conditions that you want for all time, so certainly the initial data has to satisfy them. And if you choose sigma to be zero at the initial data, then this then the solution to this equation will satisfy sigma equals zero and divergence D and B will be zero for all time, and you'll satisfy all of Maxwell's equations. So this system is exactly equivalent to Maxwell's equations when the data makes sense. But this system is well posed always, and that's a huge advantage of the FEEC approach. You don't have to, because on the discrete level, maybe you'll lose the divergence condition in some circumstances by a standard method. Okay, so that's sort of the structure that we're trying to preserve in finite element exterior calculus associated to Hilbert complexes. The next question is, how do we discretize this? And here the point is that we need to capture that structure on the discrete level. So for example, let's say we're trying to solve the Hodge-Laplacian and there are there's a one-dimensional cohomology space. That means there's a one-dimensional space of harmonic forms in the kernel, and the problem is not well posed without taking care of those forms, that one-dimensional space. That would mean that you have to put one condition on your solution in order to get a unique solution. An example would be you're solving a Neumann problem for the scalar Laplacian. You need to take that the integral of the solution is zero as to make it unique as one possible condition. Now, suppose you discretize and you don't have any harmonic forms on the discrete level. That is, the discrete problem is well posed without any side condition. Then you don't even have the possibility of telling your algorithm what side condition you placed on the exact solution. So your algorithm doesn't even know the whole problem. It can't possibly compute the solution. So you need a discrete solution. You needed a discrete method which captures the cohomology, and certainly with the right dimension to even being able to pose the correct problem. So here's in one slide summarizing what the outcome is. This is a big piece of finite element exterior calculus. We're going to solve the problems, say the Hodge-Laplacian, using the mixed weak formulation that I wrote down. That has trial functions and test functions that we look for in the spaces VK and VK minus one. And what we're going to do is replace VK on the finite discrete level by some finite dimensional subspace VKH, and similarly for VK minus one. And it turns out that, and then we use Galerkin's method to compute the solution, just restricting the test and trial functions to the subspaces. It turns out that that is stable and convergent under two crucial conditions. One is the subcomplex property, the D of VKH is contained in VK plus 1H. So that means that when you, and that's for each K, so that means that I can form a subcomplex of the original complex using our Galerkin spaces. The D's map one into the next. And the next property that we need is that there are projection operators going down, which are bounded and commute with D, the bounded cochain projection property. If you have both of those properties, sort of everything goes well. The discrete spaces themselves, as I said, form a Hilbert complex. So the whole theory of Hilbert complexes applies to them. They have their own Hodge decomposition, discrete Hodge decomposition. They have their own Poincaré inequality. They have their own Hodge-Laplace operator, which is nothing other than the discrete solution to the original Hodge-Laplace problem. And what's more, the projection operators going down induce an isomorphism on the cohomology of the top complex with the cohomology of the bottom complex. So we don't run into that problem I mentioned that you have the wrong number of harmonic forms. In fact, we have this nice isomorphism between the harmonic forms of the two spaces. So there's a lot more to do, but then this can be shown to lead to good stability and convergence properties and estimates and all sorts of results. So that brings us to a key challenge, another big part of FEEC, which is, okay, if I give you a specific complex, how do you find these subspaces VKH, which are presumably finite element spaces, so we can use them for computing efficiently, which form subcomplexes that admit bounded cochain projections. In finite elements, to build a space VKH means you triangulate your domain. On each triangle, you choose a finite dimensional space of polynomial functions, of usually polynomials of some degree, all polynomials of degree 3 or less, for example, or maybe some subspace of that. And in finite element exterior calculus, you're all often making subspaces. You use something called the Kazule differential to build subspaces. And you have to say how you tie the polynomials in one element, one triangle, to the polynomials in the next triangle by putting certain degrees of freedom for the space on the edges connecting two triangles, or on the vertices connecting multiple triangles, or in faces at higher dimensions and so forth. So I won't describe exactly what this diagram means, but that's describing the space of quadratic vector fields on a triangle. Quadratic vector fields on a triangle has dimension 12. So I have 12 little symbols here, and those symbols are indicating on the edges that three moments of the normal derivatives are continuous, which is enough to make these the normal component. Three moments of the normal component are continuous. So these finite elements would have normal continuity from one triangle to the next, which is a good thing for differential one forms. And this is the space that FEEC creates as second order differential one forms on a triangle in R2. And for the Rham complex, for the entire Rham complex, differential forms of any order in any dimension, this has been studied systematically and exhaustively. And basically we've come to the conclusion that there are two main families of finite elements on simplices in n dimensions for the differential forms of any particular degree. And this was so systematic and so appealing that we actually made a periodic table of finite elements to capture this, which is shown here. Let me just briefly say what's on here. The first three rows refer to one dimension, the second three rows to two dimensions, the third three rows to three dimensions. And of course, we could imagine this would continue to higher dimensions. In each group, there are three little sub rows, and those three rows refer to elements of degree one, elements of polynomial degree two and degree three, and those could all be continued. And then the four columns, well, the left two columns have to do with simplices. The right two columns have to do with cubes. I won't talk about those at all. And then within the columns, the subcolumns, well, say in the three dimensions, there are four subcolumns. Those are for differential zero forms, differential one forms, differential two forms, and differential three forms. And for each of these, there are two sets of three columns in the simplices and two sets of columns in the cubes. That's because FEEC turns out to say that there are two fundamental spaces, one consisting of complete polynomials and one consisting of trimmed polynomials of some sort. And I won't get into it, but these are what two of the entries of the table look like. You see there's a lot of structure to it that I won't get into. And here on the left is the element that I talked about, which is second order full polynomials for one forms on triangles in dimension two. And it turned out that this element was known long before FEEC. It has a traditional name in finite elements. It's called the Brutzi-Douglas-Marini elements of degree two, and that's what BDM stands for. And it can actually be accessed in the Phoenix finite element program using either name. All the FEEC elements can be used in Phoenix. Okay, well, that's a lot of abstraction stuff and a lot of theory. And so maybe I should have started out by making some motivated examples, but I held them for now, showing what happens if you ignore FEEC and just you don't worry about structure preserving discretization, just discretize with normal finite elements. Of course, that works wonderfully well for many problems, and finite elements are used all the time, every day. But there are fundamental problems where it fails, and I'll show academic examples, but this hints at the, of course, failure in real problems in a more complicated and subtle way. So the first one is very simple. This is the, in two dimensions, this is the Hodge-Laplacian at k equals two level, at the last level, which is the equations of Darcy-Flow. There are two variables, P and V. P is a scalar, V is a vector. V represents the velocity of the flow, P its pressure, satisfying these two equations, which of course combine to make a second order elliptic problem. But now we don't do this. We leave it as a system in P and V. And then we discretize this using that first, what I said was the standard strong form, which would be the more obvious way to solve this thing. And we use the standard finite elements that anybody who's taken one course in finite elements would do. They see this, they say, well, P has a derivative on it. Why don't we use continuous piecewise linear? No. When we take the weak form, this gradient goes over to the test function. So it becomes P div a test function W. So for V and W, where we have a divergence, we take finite elements which have one derivative, piecewise linear finite elements. So the symbol here is we have a function on a triangle and we give both of its two components, this vector function, at the vertices and determine a linear function. So it's P1 cross P1, polynomials of degree one. Well, P will not have any derivatives on it in the weak form. So we use piecewise constants, P0 elements. If we compute that way, we get complete garbage. You see this wild oscillation and you see the scale is 230,000 for the pressure. Well, the correct answer should be an order of 40 or so. And so we get complete garbage by using the standard choice of finite elements. Now we choose the finite elements from the periodic table, saying P is actually a two form in this situation, and V is a one form. And so we use the P1 elements, P1 minus lambda one elements from the periodic table. And of course, we still get a piecewise constant pressure because it turns out that P1 minus lambda two is the same as P0. It's the V1 that's different. So we still get a piecewise constant pressure. It's not very accurate, but at least it has the right tendencies. It goes from minus 40 to minus 30, I guess, the pressure. Pressure is determined up to a constant in a nearly linear fashion. By the way, I probably should have said, this is a problem where we're injecting fluid at the upper right corner and it's traveling down and being extracted at the lower left corner. That's accounting for the pressure field. If we wanted more accuracy, we would need to use higher order elements, but still from the periodic table. Here's the next higher order where we use P2 elements for one forms and two forms, and we get a very nice pressure field. Okay, another example, maybe slightly more dramatic, is we take just the Hodge-Laplacian for one forms in 2D, curl curl minus grad div u equals lambda u, with say magnetic boundary conditions. And we find the eigenvalues. So I'm solving the eigenvalue problem. And I do this with Galerkin's method. So I find a differential form U in subspace of one form satisfying this equation or with a weak form. So I could either do it with a strong form or a weak form. So suppose I use the standard finite element method for this. This is the one where I have to use the V intersect V star as the space. And I said that there are problems discretizing this. Well, this is what we get. We get that on a relatively fine mesh, the first eigenvalue is 1.9, the second is 2.2, so forth. And here are the eigenfunctions. Unfortunately, this is totally wrong. Here are the true eigenfunctions, which I computed with FEEC, but I know to be correct. They look totally different. And you notice in particular, the first eigenvalue is not 1.94, it's zero. And that we know analytically, because the first eigenfunction is zero means there's a kernel, and the kernel comes up if there's cohomology, and the one cohomology of a domain in Rn is the number of holes in the domain, the Betti number, and there is one hole, so the first eigenvalue has to be zero. And this shows you what goes wrong if you don't get the cohomology right. The standard method gets it totally wrong. It's interesting to look at the convergence history. This is the standard finite element computed with a mesh of 64 triangles, 256 triangles, 1024 triangles, all the way up to a million triangles. And these are the first six eigenvalues, and they're converging very nicely and settling down nicely to a number. And if you were doing the computations, you probably would say, oh, well, this is working great. But the problem, as I said, is what they converge to are not the true eigenvalues. They're something totally different. Well, if you do the FEEC method, you don't have that problem at all. In particular, for all meshes, you get the zero eigenvalue exactly, and the first eigenvalue very accurately, and so forth. And one final example as a motivator for FEEC. This is the so-called Maxwell eigenvalue problem. If you do it in 2 or 3D, the D operator here is essentially the curl. I do this at the level of one forms. And so this is curl U is equal to lambda U. And that's a problem that can be solved exactly if you're on a square by separation of variables. And the eigenvalues are the positive sums of squares. There's also the zero eigenvalues because curl has a kernel, but the positive eigenvalues are the sums of squares. So the first two are one and one from one plus zero and zero plus one squared. And then we'll get four and four from zero, two and two, zero and so forth. So now I take a particular sequence of meshes, these structured meshes, these crisscross meshes, first 16 by elements, then 64 elements, then 256 elements and so forth. And I compute the eigenvalues of the discrete operator using standard P1 finite elements. This naive method that doesn't worry about structure preservation. And you see, we do indeed get convergence down to two as the first eigenvalue, one plus one. But sorry, I was wrong before. I said one plus zero. It's both M and N have to be positive. So the lowest eigenvalue is one plus one. The next one is one plus four and four plus one. And the next one would be four plus four, I get eight. And we see this is working. We're converging to two, we're converging to one plus four, five as a double eigenvalue, we're converging to eight, but we have this problem, we're also converging to six. And now you can spend some time to try to find six as the sum of two squares and don't succeed in doing that. So actually the six on this table and the 15 on this table that we're converging to are completely wrong. The standard finite element method finds the right eigenvalues on these crisscross meshes and also find spurious eigenvalues. So that's a nightmare. Again, you would likely be fooled if you just saw this table. And if you do the same computation with FEEC, you have no problem at all. You get the 2, 5, 5, 8, 10, 10, and the spurious eigenvalues disappear and everything converges nicely. So the structure preservation makes a huge difference in many fundamental problems. Okay, and what I'd like to do with the end of the talk is talk about some recent progress in this area, moving beyond the Rham complex, talking about other complexes. So from the beginning, we were actually motivated by solving the elasticity problem, which involves another complex. It's what led us to this theory. But there was a long digression to understand the Rham complex completely. In the periodic table, for example, is only for the Rham complex. Nobody's really come up with the extensions of that to other complexes yet. And I think that's a big direction for things to grow in. So the elasticity complex is this Hilbert complex listed at top in three dimensions. We start instead of with scalar functions, which are zero forms, we start with vector valued functions. And the first operator is not the gradient, but the symmetric gradient. which maps us into symmetric matrix fields. The second operator is a little bit more complicated. It maps symmetric matrix fields to symmetric matrix fields in the following way. It's a second order operator. You take a symmetric matrix field, you take the curl of each row of that matrix field, and you get another matrix, no longer symmetric. And then you take the curl of each column, you get a new matrix field, which is symmetric with symmetry restored. Another way to say that, we call that the INC for incompatibility operator. Another way to say that is this is the linearization of the Einstein curvature. If you think of the first symmetric matrix as being a metric or a metric increment, this is the linearized Einstein curvature of that metric. And then the final operator is the divergence operator, row by row of the symmetric matrix, which is a linearized contraction of the Bianchi identity, if you want. So this is a Hilbert complex. And that means at each level, we have a well-posed Hodge-Laplacian. The first one is the elasticity operator written in standard form. The last one, if we go to the level of the last space, L2 omega R3, the Hodge-Laplacian for that is the elasticity operator written in mixed form. And that's what we were motivated to try to find, mixed finite elements for elasticity, which had been a long open problem. In fact, it had been open for 40 years, and this approach found the first solution to that problem. The incompatibility operator is very interesting. It's called what it's called because it tells you exactly what are the conditions for a symmetric operator matrix field to be an infinitesimal strain of a displacement field. These spaces, these four spaces really correspond in elasticity to displacement, strain, stress, and load. And the incompatibility operator tells what are the conditions for a symmetric matrix field to be a strain field. And it's very useful in the theory of elastoplasticity and dislocation. So that gives us some more problems that we can solve with these things. And I just have one picture down there, which is sort of similar to the ones I showed before. What happens if you compute a nearly incompressible elasticity problem using standard standard finite elements versus the ones that you get from the FEEC theory? And you see it makes a huge difference again. Another complex which has been less studied is the Hessian complex. And notice, by the way, this complex also involves a second order operator, just like the previous one did. The incompatibility operator was second order. The Hessian operator starts with a scalar field, takes its Hessian to get a symmetric matrix field. Then you'd have the curl operator that maps symmetric matrix fields into trace-free matrix fields. The curl of a symmetric matrix is trace-free. And then you have the divergence operator mapping into vector fields. This operator also has many uses. On the left end, it's very useful for solving the Kirchhoff-Plate equation that's being investigated now. In the middle, the curl operator from symmetric matrix fields to tensor fields is what you need to do the Einstein-Bianchi formulation of general relativity. That was work done in a thesis of a student of mine, Vincent Kenneville, and there's ongoing work in that area. And now, I'm gonna just rush through this just to give you some rough idea of this latest paper, which is joint work with Kaibo Hu and is now on archive. And it's the idea of, well, why those three complexes? Are there other complexes? How do you get complexes? And if you wanted to discretize them, how would you approach it? Finding subcomplexes with bounded cochain projections. And so we created a construction, which is related to the Bernstein-Gelfond-Gelfond resolution in Lie theory, in representation of Lie algebras. And I'll just roughly, quickly point out how it goes. You start with two bounded Hilbert complexes. These are bounded, not L2. So typically the first space would be some Sobolev space, V0 would be some HS. And then V1 would be, if D was a first order operator, V1 would be HS minus one. And the HS functions may have values in something other than scalars. That's what the E0, E1 are. Those are finite dimensional Hilbert spaces. and we have two different ones on the top complex and the bottom, and we use the same Sobolev spaces but offset by one. So if V0 was HS and V1 was HS minus one, then V1 would be HS minus one at the start of the second complex as well. V2 would be, et cetera. Okay, so we have these two complexes. Then we put operators little s that takes the e's on the bottom to the next e on the top, little diagonal operators. So for example, they might be the operator that takes, say, a matrix field to a scalar field by taking its trace. The little s might be the trace operator. And since the v's are the same, we can put an identity in tensor with identity, and we get these linking maps going up diagonally, the capital S's. And we have two requirements on these, and I'll just rush through them. One of these S's is bijective, and the ones to the left are injective, and the ones to the right are surjective. And we also have to have anti-commutativity of these little parallelograms, SD equals minus DS. Step three is we reduce the spaces. So we go to these complexes that we started with, and we make the E spaces smaller by taking those things in E that are orthogonal to the incoming S arrows on the top, and the bottom we take the things that are in the null space of the outgoing S arrows. We do this for the first J spaces on the top and the last N minus J spaces on the bottom. And now we have these two reduced partial complexes, and we splice them together by going to a piece of the diagram with the linking diagram, remembering that we assumed SJ was bijective, and going back backwards onto this and introducing a composition of D tilde ND. So that's the crazy construction. Here I do it in one slide. Start with two complexes, put in the linking maps, reduce the spaces, and splice them together. And that's how you get a new Hilbert complex. And this theorem says that the cohomology of the output complexes is just the direct sum of the cohomology of the input complexes. And now I'm going to really rush through it, give some examples. In these examples, we always start with a Rham sequence, which has values in alternating J linear forms and alternating J plus one linear forms. This can be put in the form that I said with V's and E's and E tildes, as the way I wrote it. And the little S operators you have to introduce take these tensor products, map these tensor products as shown. So they map a multilinear form, which is alternating its first I variables and its last J plus one variables, to one that's alternating in its first I plus one variables and its last J variables. That's a natural object to define. You can prove it satisfies our hypotheses. And so here I put all the possibilities in 3D. You could take any two of these sequences in a row and do our operation and get new complexes. If you do the first two, you get the Hessian complex. The first operator is the bijection. If you do the second two, you get the elasticity complex, with the second operator being the bijection. If you do the third, you get another complex called the div-div complex, which is very useful in plate problems of a different sort. You can even take two of the S operators and do the first and the third, and you get new complexes, or the second and the fourth and new complexes, or even the first and the fourth and new complexes. So all these generate new complexes. And you can even do more, which I won't go into. And then the last three slides, which I'll skip for lack of time, give a hint on how you might go use this construction on a discrete level to take two discrete complexes with have the right conditions and combine them and get a new discrete complex which satisfies the conditions of FEEC and begins to get you a periodic table of finite elements for these new complexes. And I'll stop there.
My shock. It was a really interesting talk. Let's see if the audience has any questions for you.
Okay.
I will ask you the following question. Obviously, this method has wide applications, and I'm curious, how would you judge the current usage in various fields of knowledge of more advanced finite element methods? I'm particularly interested how is meteorology or climate science are doing in this respect? Are they on board?
That's actually a very interesting example. The case of meteorology and climate modeling is one where FEEC has been adopted well, particularly in Britain, in the UK. The Met Office, the meteorology office of the UK, one of their main codes is called LFRIC, which stands for LF Richardson. And they just made a rewrite of LFRIC to base it on finite element exterior calculus. The key guy pushing this is a guy named Colin Cotter at Imperial. And he and a large group have been studying finite element exterior calculus for the shallow water equations, geostrophic equations, Euler equations. And this has been, as I say, adopted in Britain in real production level codes. So it's probably one of the most advanced areas that it's moved into production.
Mm-hmm. That's actually, it sounds encouraging.
When you're dealing with incompressible flow, the big difficulty, of course, is the incompressibility condition that the divergence should be zero. The structure preserving approach is to come up with a numerical method that satisfies the divergence constraint exactly, not just a high order. Mass is conserved exactly. But if you're doing Navier-Stokes equations, you also have to have some continuity on the elements. For a long time, this was thought, I mean, for a long time, like the first 35 years of my career, this was thought to be too much to ask. You couldn't do it. Now it's almost becoming regarded as essential. Many people have found ways to do this. And the so-called Stokes complex and finite element exterior calculus is one way to get a handle on this problem. Quite a few people have worked on that.
Thank you.
Doug?
Are there any?
Yeah.
Michael has a question.
Yeah, great talk. Could you say a few more words about metric geometry, both, you know, Einstein's equations, Riemannian geometry, problems with the metric?
Well, I must say, I think if you go all the way back to my 2002 ICM talk, I was already saying that I'm hopeful that this will make a big difference for numerical relativity. I have to say it has not made a big difference for numerical relativity up till now. Of course, we all know that numerical relativity is a hot subject that was very much motivated by getting there in time for LIGO, basically having a computation. And of course, fantastic congratulations on succeeding. But they were not using structure preserving methods, I would say, for the most part. There's quite a bit of interest in doing this now that they've gotten to that one first goal. Now they can take more time and apply other methods. And there's a lot of interest in this. And we've done some work on this. There are a few different approaches. One is related to Regi calculus and discrete metrics. One is related to this Einstein-Bianchi formulation. And there are some other ones that are being looked at. So far, almost all of the results are in the linearized case. And there are difficulties with some of the non-linearities that arise in relativity. And so the jury is in some sense out. I think it's a great time to work on this. It's being discussed somewhat at ICERM now, which is having a program on numerical relativity.
Thanks.
The Regi calculus example is a very interesting one. The lowest order case of FEEC, of the periodic table, was actually not discovered by finite element people. It was discovered by Hassler-Whitney in his book. It was viewed as topology, and we even call them the Whitney forms. The equivalent, the Regi elements, the Regi metrics can be thought of as sort of the Whitney forms for metrics. They're a low order finite element for metrics that can be fit into a complex, but it's a very low order complex in which some of the spaces are distributions. And people are trying to make sense of that.
Thanks.
Any more questions?
Hello, Shintong.
Nice talk.
Thank you.
Hope that you can come back physically sometime.
That would be nice. I'd love to see the Institute.
Yeah.
The center.
Yeah. Right. Hey,
maybe I can ask a simple question. Sorry.
Yeah.
Is it obvious how to do that when you also have spaces with boundaries? Is it a simple application of that? Because I know the cohomology structure and all these things are a bit more complicated in this way, in this case.
I think boundary conditions are something that finite element approach handles very well. So, the simplest case would be if we put boundary conditions on the whole domain. And we would have, say, instead of the Rham complex with boundary conditions. It has different cohomology, but it's exactly captured by the finite element version, can be discretized. And actually, the case of mixed boundary conditions, where you put the essential boundary conditions on part of the domain and non-essential elsewhere, it creates different cohomology, but again, it's captured. And this case has been studied also with finite element exterior calculus by Martin Licht. So there are papers on that. But there, it turns out to work fine.
I see, thanks.
Okay, our time is up. But you can stay on this channel in case you want to ask more questions.